one room and sort of get like a unified understanding, because that's really important to have a basic understanding of the product. And it's very important that all of the stakeholders feel as equal stakeholders. And, you know, like I would like really involve them in brainstorming activities, get some ideas from them, and sort of like whiteboard, so that everyone feels that they're, you know, like incorporated into the project, and, you know, they can all become like, they can all have a buy-in to the project. And I also think like this is like a really good part for UX designers, because we can really advocate for design at this point in time and get a buy-in from the contributors. And slowly going down in the process, of course, there would be a lot of research, but I would make sure that I keep the PMs and other stakeholders as like pretty much in the information flow, so that they are all aware of what's happening. And slowly down the process, it would be reduced to sort of meetings where we can like come and talk about like the project development, and if there are any issues that are faced by the users or by the stakeholders, we can sort it out together. So yeah, that would be my process.
Awesome. Thank you so much. That's very, very, like, I love how you like went into a lot of detail. And there's one thing that you said that really is super important, which is making everyone feel equal. You know, I know we even went through like the product managers, UX designers and developers, but a lot of times people don't feel like that relationship is equal. And even I even want to like, you know, go into you, Malika, you know, as the engineer who was really in charge of actually making sure that things happen, like the code actually gets written. Sometimes it's like, you know, you're the last person that things get passed to. So how do you make sure that, you know, how do you work on teams to make sure like you still feel that equality, that you're an equal member of the team and you want to be brought in the important times? How do you, like, could you give us any examples from, you know, times when that has happened?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I'll try to keep it as concise and brief, because I can just think of so many examples, good and bad. So probably like the worst thing that could happen to you, and this has happened, is exactly what you said, Shifumi, like being brought in like very last minute and not having the full understanding of what's being built, why it's being built, and what the priorities are there. And then things being pushed kind of last minute. That leaves you with an engineering team that's hard pressed for time, feeling like they're not valued, feeling like they're working overtime, like on weekends, getting things out. And it leaves you honestly with not a great product, with not great quality, right? So that's kind of like the worst end of the spectrum, or even worse is like, yeah, slipping deadlines, which I would argue is actually not as bad as dropping on quality. But yeah, and on the other spectrum is, how do you find that balance? Because most companies, most good teams and good organizations that are technology focused do appreciate their engineers a decent amount. And my time at Microsoft, for the most part, has been, you know, like you're very much welcomed, and your input on the engineering design, even on the product, is welcomed, because at the end of the day, a lot of the engineers are the ones saying what is and isn't feasible. So it's very, so their input is taken into consideration for sure. The interesting thing there is not every engineer actually wants to be involved in those conversations, because their problem is, I'm an engineer, I don't want to be in these meetings, right? That's not my job. And so the really interesting balance, and this becomes a problem for engineering managers as well as product managers and, you know, designers, is how do you include engineers enough that they feel included without them being like, oh my God, like you want an engineer in every single one of your meetings. So that's kind of like the sweet spot to try to hit. And, you know, just with the right amount of input from engineers, and where they're not feeling like they're roped in too much and not being left out.
Yeah, that's a solid point. I was actually going to even like go back to that point, because I know Mehek talked about, you know, having a lot of meetings at some point. And, you know, there's this myth that engineers don't like meetings. Like, you know, you don't want to be putting in meetings, they just want to code all day. So, you know, Mehek, if you can really talk a little bit more about, you know, you want to include the team in the design process. And even Malika also talked about, you know, some engineers want to be brought in at the right time. How do you find that balance at, you know, bringing them at the right time? Is there a general right time, or how do you get a sense for what that is when you're working on teams?
Sure. So I think personally, I always feel that initially in the process or the project, when we're all building a similar sort of understanding, it's very important to involve everyone. But as Malika said, like that makes a lot of sense because not every role is sort of similarly involved. And, you know, different roles have like different importance, and they play a very pivotal role at a different time in of the entire process. And it's very important to sort of like understand that. And you know, like I would definitely say that you know, like going ahead in the process, once you all have the similar understanding, then you know, like meetings generally shift into like once like a weekly catch up, where we can understand from pretty much all of the teams that what is the process. Or how soon, how far have we reached in the progress of the project, and what are some of the issues that we are facing? And this is this is like a really good time to be able to understand what the other, what are the problems that are faced by the other teams, and how can we sort it out within a very stipulated timeline and also a very stipulated cost.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, timelines are super important. I know Mehek, you talked about it, Malika as well. And if I could pass it over to you, Anthony, you know, the timeline is pretty much yours to manage, right? It's like up to you whether the product ships or not. You know, strangely, even though there's like the equal balance of, you know, everyone is an equal member, but ultimately they look to the PMs to make sure things get shipped. So how do you get the team excited, Anthony, whenever you're working on a project? How do you get them excited and aligned on that vision so they feel equal throughout the process?
Yeah, so to get the team excited and aligned to the product vision, what I would do is I'll clearly outline what I want to build and why I'm building it, right? And then connecting the benefits and outcomes to the product vision, right? So by doing that, I'm encouraging buy-in within the team, right? Getting buy-in from the designers, getting buy-in from developers and other internal stakeholders. That buy-in is what gets them and keeps them excited about working in a particular product or feature. The second thing I would do is engage with my developers, designers, or other internal stakeholders to get their feedback throughout the process, right? By actively listening and understanding the different constraints. Again, this feedback feeds back into the design process, which will continue to build buy-in.
Cool, awesome. So yeah, buying is super, super important. Like I used to be a product manager, and getting the team, you know, excited was like, you know, my top goal and everything that I always lived and breathed to do, because if my team isn't happy, I don't think that we'll be able to get anything done. Actually, I would like to even pause and take a question, you know, from the chat. We have a nice question from Ibrahim here. And also feel free, if you had any more questions, put it in the chat. We'll continue that conversation because I want to keep you all as engaged as possible. So in terms of setting KPIs, so we have a question about setting KPIs. You know, the KPIs sometimes are owned by the product managers in some organizations. Anthony, do you agree or not? Yeah. So yeah. This question is about like, in at what stage do design teams set those KPIs? So Meg, you can also like chime in, but I wanted to then just chat quickly about, you know, KPIs. If the PM set it, how do the designers come and also fit into that picture? And if you have any examples off the top of your head, but if not, just generally just talk about the process of how the KPIs flow from like product managers to UX designers and how they can collaborate on making sure they meet those KPIs.
Sure. So I think in my organization currently as well, so the KPIs pretty much come from the product side. And as well as that, like the design always tries to match the KPIs in terms of having like very UX oriented KPIs that can help the product overall. And usually this is achieved by, again, having a lot of discussions and a lot of times like, you know, like alignment with the product. And since like being a UX designer, I pretty much would understand like what the users need and what can be done in terms of making the product really usable. And you know, so this part would sort of flow into the KPI, and then we would sort of like match it to what the product owner or the organization really wants. And this can be achieved through a lot of things like frequent experimentation. So because but through that, like, we can have like a really strong hold on what's working and what's not, and then we can also pretty much stay within the same vision as the product team, and also be able to maybe like push back on certain points. And I think as designers, this is like a role that's coming up really frequently now, that, you know, like, we're not only designing UIs, but then we can also, through using some sort of data and through some sort of research, we can also come and, you know, like, help the product teams build a better product and achieve their KPIs.
Awesome. Okay, that's super important. Thank you so much for sharing that, and, you know, how the flow actually, you know, works from the PM to you. And, you know, the KPIs is everyone's job, including even the developer. So even Malik, I wanted to even, you know, pass it on to you and ask about, you know, a lot of the times, you know, some folks don't really understand the technical side. Things that Anthony even talked about when getting the team aligned, getting that buy-in is also important, that when it's coming up with features, you know, it's like the dev team is involved and it's possible and it's realistic. So how do you invite others to really understand what you do on the technical side, so it's not daunting and we don't have any of the assumptions that we have, you know, when we want to design or build features for our users?
Yeah, definitely. And so this question will kind of vary, like, depending on the type of product you're working on. So I work within Azure Compute. Within Azure Compute, I work on a product called Azure Arc for Kubernetes, which is around hybrid computing. And the nature of the product is so technical that it would be very challenging for a product manager or a designer that is non-technical to come in, and kind of like the ramp up period would be much like longer, right? Versus if you are working on something that was a little bit more understandable, at least from the user's point of view, like let's say it was a mobile app or a web app or something that is more tangible, if that makes sense. So that's kind of like to start off, right? Like trying to understand what type of product you're working on and like who are the PMs and designers that are working with you and what background do they come from? Usually we have, and this has seemed to work relatively well, the product managers, designers do actually take part in the engineering design discussions. So they are heavily involved. They may not be the ones, they are definitely not the ones writing the engineering design docs, but they are 100% present for them and they are doing their best to contribute there. And I would almost go as far as to say, like, the from what I've noticed, like the product managers, at least on my team, that have, you know, participated in that, like, start gaining that knowledge and that context more and more and more. And then they are actually able to come up with features that are more feasible. You start having less of these issues of, no, that's not possible, actually. And they've only found that out after talking to some engineer, right? Like, they themselves are able to make, no, I don't think that's possible, but let me double check and, like, let me confirm my hypothesis on this thing with the engineering lead. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a very, 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 very great answer, Malika. Thank you so much for sharing that. Because one thing that I also wanted to add is, you know, it's everyone's job to make sure we all build a great product, right? And I think the earlier we understand that, the better it is also better for the user. I love the fact that you mentioned that everyone is involved in the process. Yes, even though this could be like a very technical doc, but everyone needs to participate to make sure that they're doing right by the user, to make sure that, hey, you know, we're all respecting each other and not saying, hey, you should just do this, you should just build this, without, and then getting that pushback that, hey, this is not possible. And then your PM, you know, going back and forth. So that collaboration aspect is like super important. And there's another question. This is also a great segue, which is another question in the chat by Kenny. Who says, like, you know, while the PM is doing their thing, like doing a lot of the work, you know, ahead of time, you know, how do you make sure that there's not enough, like, you don't wait too long before getting input from the dev or the design team while, like, you know, because I know, Anthony, you mentioned, you know, putting a doc together, getting all the stakeholders, talking to users. How do you make sure that you're not waiting too long before, you know, like Malika said, they have that context that, hey, this is possible, this is feasible. Even design can give their input very early on. So Anthony, would you like to, like, chime in on that?
Sure, yeah. So that's why initially, once I've stated the problem statements, the next thing that I would work on is like a really high level document where I would include like use cases. I think by sharing like a list of use cases to both the designers or the developers. It will give them a sense of, hey guys, it's a heads up. We're planning to work on these potential capabilities. This will allow them to start brainstorming how to approach those areas, and it will give the PM additional time to go back and lay out the details, which later on can be shared within the product team.
Awesome. That's super key. Similar experience that I've had as well as product managers, to just like give people a heads up, hey, this is what I'm thinking. You know, do you have any ideas? I'm just like letting them just like do their thing. I think that's like so important. And Mehek, like over to you, like how do you then use the contributions from the others on your team? Because I know you mentioned making sure like people are participating as equal members. You put all the stakeholders in the room, including developers. So how do you use each of those contributions? So if someone gives an idea, because you know the idea is coming from the PM and from the users, but how do you take other people's ideas and make sure that that also, you know, comes, shows up in the product one way or another, or at the end of it improves the user experience of the product?
Cool, thanks. That's a great question. And I think as designers, like as Anthony said, that like he would always intimate us about the overall higher needs. So this is the time like when a UX superpower comes into play. So which is that we do really a lot of iterations on each of these ideas. We just put them into like really quick wireframes, and we sort of like have our own repository ready where we are on the sides even discussing these solutions with the researchers. And again, like discussing the same with the product managers and sort of seeing where where a certain solution would really go. And I think especially in startups, like, or even other companies, it's always, it's a good saying that, you know, like fail fast and fail often, which means that, you know, you just iterate on a lot of ideas and then you can like discuss this with the entire team and discuss like the technical feasibility of it so that you don't really waste a lot of time in order to like build something that's not going to be useful to the users. And with the design team also, there's a lot of other teams that are involved in this process. So for example, research does its own bit, and sometimes even user experience designers do the research and sort of like validate the product requirements. And then we also have like a lot of other teams internally in design that are helping us. So maybe like the design system team, you know, that already gives us like, you know, some sort of components that we can use in the existing solution, so that, you know, like we are not taking up too much time to really build from scratch. And also, like, I think a business or the product plays a really important role over here, because they could have a lot of business insights, so that, you know, like they would always have a hypothesis and that's being sort of tested, and then we sort of work towards that. So yeah, I think.
Awesome. Lots of discussions for sure. Seems like you've been in a lot of meetings, but I think it's super important to get everyone's buy-in. And this is even outside of the conversation with your designer and your PM. So there's the other brother team that you can bring in to get different contexts, which is important. So I also even wanted to segue into like a time where collaboration actually didn't work well. So Malika, you know, as the developer, I think, you know, we want to like really focus that attention on you. Could you give us an example where, you know, you've worked on a team where the team members were not so collaborative, and just like how did that play out like for you or your team?
Well, fortunately it was my old team at Microsoft, and this is just an example that pops up. And it's probably a year or two ago now. I was working within the Office organization within Microsoft, and I had a PM. He was relatively new to the space, but he was a senior PM. So understand that a lot of like these large organizations, like bureaucracy and like just kind of like your title, like also plays a role within this collaboration, right? Like when you're thinking about collaboration, like chances are the way you're talking to someone who's at your level is different than how you're talking to someone who's like a principal or a partner and like so on, right? So yeah, he was definitely like several levels like above me. And he kind of came up to me and he said like, hey, like, yeah, like what's the status on XYZ feature? And I said, yeah, like it's in progress, and this is the timelines, and this is when I'm gonna get it done. A week after that, he's like, oh, like we need to add this. And I was like, no, I don't think that's possible. And I felt like fairly confident saying it, despite him being more senior to me. And I said, yeah, like that's really not possible. And I also don't think it's the right design because of X, Y, Z reason. He pretty much like didn't buy it and said like, no, like this needs to be done, like put a lot of pressure on me. And at that time, since I was still like, you know, only a year into my career, I felt a lot of pressure and I felt like I had to work like the weekends and everything and try to get it done. And as I was like working on it, I really didn't think it was the right like experience. I really did not think, I did not agree with like what he was building. But again, like I was trying to like stay within the realm of my job of being a developer and not questioning what the product was doing. A week or two later, he talked to another PM who was more senior than him. And he said, and he pretty much confirmed what I said. And then my PM came up to me and he's like, oh, actually, no, we need to do it this way. And like, to me, I'm just like, that's what I've been saying for weeks. I've been saying this for weeks and you ruined my weekends and weeknights. And, you know, like the truth is it will just happen every now and then. I don't think there's a way around it. Chances are no one's actually trying to screw you over. Like for the most part, like 99.9% of times, like it's a lack of information. It's a lack of communication. It's a lack of something right somewhere. And so like on his side, he could have been more well-versed in the technical side and given me a little bit more credit, despite me being a junior engineer. And on my side, I could have been involved in some of those PM conversations to understand what it is he was really trying to do. And so if you are an engineer or if you are an aspiring engineer, I almost think it's very crucial for like junior engineers to be part of some of the big picture conversations, because you'll always notice at organizations, the principal engineers, the engineering managers, they kind of know, like they have a top level view and a breadth of what's happening, you know, what kind of features are coming in. They're kind of talking to PMs a little bit, but the junior engineers, you know, I'm talking 1 year, 2 year, 3 year into your career, these are the ones who are just left with build this feature, and then they don't have much of a context left. So yeah, highly, highly recommend talking to your PM, setting up some time.
That's such a great answer, Malika. Thank you so much for sharing that personal story. And, you know, I'm sorry about that hard time. I know no one ever wants to be in a situation where you're just like told what to do. And I think that's just a testament of why we're having this discussion, which is you never ever want to be in a position where you're just telling someone to do something. You know, building a product is supposed to be collaborative. Like, you know, he missed the context about that. You know, he didn't bring her early on to try and achieve that. And I think the lack of collaboration then causes like distrust. Because he didn't trust her, then you have to go ask someone else and then before they confirm. So you don't want to get to a place where, you know, you don't have that trust in team members, because then they wouldn't want to work with you or they wouldn't want to, you know, spend time with you. So it's really important to foster those relationships. So now over to you, Anthony, you know, as the PM who is, you know, mostly telling people, hey, what to do, what not to do. We have like a very interesting question in the chat, which is like, you know, what workshops or, you know, activities do you use to sort of just like align the team? Like maybe do you have like OKR workshops to make sure like all the stakeholders are aligned outside of like the process that you've like laid out with coming up with like a deck and bringing people in earlier? Do you have any other tips to share about that?
Yeah, so going back to the earlier points about inviting the designers or engineers to every single meeting. So it's important to share the high level vision of what you want to work on, right? With the business stakeholders first, right? It could be the sales team, the marketing team, maybe the CEO. Once you have their buy-in and they're aligned with what you want to work on, then you could transfer that information to the engineering team or the design team. So that's first of all, you're valuing their time and their resources, and you're protecting them from being distracted with unnecessary meetings.
So one theme that I'm seeing coming up here, and thank you so much for the answer, Anthony, is the communication, the importance of communication. I think Malika touched on it, you know, Anthony just even touched on it just again, which is outside of your core skills as a designer, as a PM, as a developer, it's important to communicate so everyone gets context and everyone has access to that information so that they can do the things that they need to do to build successful products. So that's also another thing that I want you all to like take from this, is the importance of communication and making sure that everyone on your team has that context and has the information. We have a question from Jason Mack, and I want you to take this one, which is, as someone who's currently in a bootcamp program, what ways can they gain the experience working with PMs and developers? Because now this is all about collaborating. They want to make sure like they're collaborating very early on in the process. Do you have any tips? I definitely have one, but I would definitely like you to take a crack at it first.
So, sure. So, I mean, I think like what has really worked out for me is like, first of all, like just try to understand your PM. And that could be also like pretty much like outside of your daily meetings, for example, like, you know, sort of just like take out the time to just interact with them and just sort of build a relationship or like, you know, like a place of trust where you can like really talk to each other. And this also really helps in sort of, you know, like, having the buy-in from the PMs itself, so that, you know, like a lot of times, like what Malika said, like there's a lot of bureaucracy and, you know, like there are people at a very high end who will not really accommodate or like listen to, you know, what a junior designer has to say. So I think one of an effective method is to just like, and especially I think like being working in a startup like Agoda, that has worked really well, that, you know, you just grab some time for a meeting or like just go out for like a coffee. So this is like the initial bit where you sort of like build trust. Then I would really encourage you to sort of even, you know, like show a different, you know, show a deeper side, which is not only like work related, but, you know, sort of just go up to your PM and be like, hey, I'm really interested in this topic. And, you know, like, I'm really interested to build this in the best way possible, and sort of, you know, like sort of get a buy-in from them, get their time, and get time from some other stakeholders as well. And just like, you know, be able to understand the problem with them. And this, to be honest, like a lot of times I feel as a younger designer, we sometimes fail to say that, you know, like we've not really understood something. When I go to a PM, I sometimes just tell them like, hey, you know what? I do not have a technical understanding. Just explain something to me like I was like a 7-year-old, you know, just like simplify it and just make sure you tell me what it is, and I will do my best to understand it and sort of like be able to collaborate with you. And I'm pretty much on your team. That's what I would do.
Awesome. Thank you, Mehak. And Malika, I want to also give you a chance to answer, because I know you've mentioned you had an answer. But for, you know, someone who hasn't even gotten a chance to work in a company yet, doesn't have that experience, they've just started in their journey, what advice would you give them, or what tips would you give them?
I think I'm stealing yours, Shifumi.
No worries. It's okay. It's all good.
But yeah, honestly, I think everything Mehak said is very relevant and very important for, you know, when you're starting out on that first job. And I have had a lot of friends, my own sister, who's tried to break into tech from a non-technical background. And I do think a platform like Co.Lab, you know, really allows you to build that expertise or showcasing of your example without having too much stress attached to it. I think it's very nerve-wracking to prepare for an interview and do the right thing and like just have these like high like risk like things involved. And I think Co.Lab kind of strips all of those things away from it and like brings you to the core of what you would do if you were actually working in the position. Right. And I think that's what's really great about it. And I'll let Shifumi talk about it a little more.
Thank you so much for that great and honest answer. I really appreciate it. And yeah, I think for everyone in the crowd looking to gain that real world experience, you know, I think, you know, Co.Lab is a good way. I know we've spent a lot of time talking about, you know, building that trust, you know, doing that communication, bringing people in, you know, brainstorming ideas, working together and making sure that everyone is aligned and treated as an equal. And that's one of the things that, you know, we spend time trying to get have done at Co.Lab to give you that real life experience or what it feels like to work at a tech company. So this is like the first step that you need to take before you land that first role, to know that, you know, you're confident, you're capable, you have what it takes, and you're definitely going to crush it when you get to that first role. So I definitely recommend anyone who is just finishing bootcamp, who is self-taught and wants to gain that experience of collaborating in a real product team, to know what it feels like, you know, the ups and downs, you know, come through Co.Lab, get that real world experience, and you get the chance to really succeed as you go into the industry. I know, you know, we're almost, you know, out of time, but I wanted to open it up for questions from the chat. So, you know, instead of just me asking questions, I know we still have some in the chat, but, you know, definitely feel free to like put in specific questions that you have. Feel free to ask anyone, like Anthony, Malika, Mehek, write their names. Felix, just quick question. Would people be able to unmute their mics, or should I just read out the chat, the questions from the chat?
Yes, for sure. So you guys will be able to unmute your mic. Please turn on your camera as well, introduce yourself, and then, you know, direct your question to either a specific mentor on the call or just directly it to the entire crowd here.
Cool. Awesome. So, thank you so much for that. Yeah. So if you have a question, just raise your hand using the feature on Zoom so we can call you appropriately. So once you raise your hand, I'll call your name. Then you feel free to like unmute your mic and showcase your video so you can ask the question that you would like. So, you know, anyone? Okay, cool. I see Karan leads. Yeah, sorry, did I say your name right? Karan?
It's pronounced Karan.
Karan, yeah. Karan, yeah, awesome. Yeah, so what question do you have for any of us?
Don't worry, bro. You're not going to be this person to be like, is that how you pronounce it? Like, don't worry. Yeah, so like, does anyone have any like agile experience, like working agile? Like, what's it like? What have been some highs? What have been some lows? Like, I've been to a bunch of these ADPs, but I haven't heard anyone talking agile, but like, yet we're in tech. So it's like, is that only for the devs, or does, you know, like, do designers work agile? Like, where does it end? Like, if it even starts, you know what I'm saying? So agile, go.
Yeah, cool. Awesome. I can take a stab at that quickly, and then, you know, anyone else can chime in. I think being agile is everyone's responsibility. It's not, you know, just for the PM, the designer, the developer. And by agile, what we mean is trying to reduce waste and trying to make sure the team is productive and regularly doing things right by the customer. So that means, you know, asking the right questions. That means planning your stuff. That means everybody having context, you know, not just the PMs, the designers, but also down to the developers, being able to point and scope things and know that, hey, this is my bandwidth, this is what I can take on for a set period of time, which you can call a sprint. And then that, when you then get into the groove of working, you also start to look back at how well you're doing as a team. Are there any bottlenecks? Are there any ways that you can improve? Being agile is very important for any tech company because it allows them to really measure how well they're doing and how well, you know, people work as a team. So you can measure a lot of things. So it can also be quantifiable. So being agile is super important. And the earlier you can start gaining that agile experience, the better it is for you. So you can definitely gain some agile experience, you know, before getting into tech. And then when you're into tech, it's just going to be a breeze when you're going through those rituals, such as like, you know, doing your daily stand-ups, you know, doing your planning, doing your grooming. But yeah, it's everyone's responsibility. Everyone plays a role in it. So anyone, feel free to like jump in, Anthony, Malika, Mehek, about, you know, what's it like being agile in your companies?
No, I want to chime in there as well. I mean, I'm not one of the speakers here, but I want to ask a question to that question, right? Because a lot of people use agile, but I think, like, you know, like that is a great framework, but you know, like, maybe we can do a little bit of comparison, like as to like, when do we kind of like do waterfall versus like agile, you know, like what are the pros and cons versus, because like there are multiple companies and like startups and like doing very different you know, like methods, waterfall versus agile, which are the two most popular ones. But maybe like you guys can shed some light on that as well. That'll be interesting.
Yeah, cool. I've already spoken, so I definitely want to give someone else a chance to speak, and definitely, so yeah, does anyone want to chime in and talk about that?
So I would just like to chime in like a little bit. So I think my process, my experience with agile has been like really great, but it's just that like sometimes, you know, just because you're, especially as a designer, that a lot of times, like, you know, like if everything is like really set out in front of you, sometimes it becomes difficult to sort of iterate on a lot of parallel ideas. For example, like, you know, like I sometimes feel that, you know, it just somewhat limits your ability to sort of like think out of the box, because like we're going in a very, very stipulated time limit. So, but other than that, in terms of progress, it's like a really great framework.
Cool. Does anyone
else? I can chime in a bit as well. So I had a previous experience in waterfall methodology, and you know, I based on what Felix said, there are definitely pros and cons, right? But we have to take into consideration the size of the product or the feature that we want to release. For example, say if you work in a government organization and you need to work on really complex system, right? Then perhaps a waterfall approach may make sense, because you need to list out all the, you have to understand the problems you want to solve, list out all the different constraints and all the different features or capabilities that you want to work on, have those flushed out, I guess, from the security team, compliance, and other stakeholders, right? Before you can pass that information to the development team to work on it. Now, in another scenario, when you work in a startup or a mid-sized company where you want to release a semi-complex product or feature, then you know it's easier to utilize the agile methodology, where you can quickly reiterate the design with the designers and quickly change the requirements or capabilities based on some of the technical constraints by talking to developers.
Cool. Awesome. Thanks for adding that. I hope we're able to answer your question, Karan. Cool. Probably have time for another question. So does anyone else want to raise up their hand to ask a question? Feel free to do so and we'll be happy to answer it. We do still have some questions in the chat, but if you want to just like unmute your mics and, you know, just like just ask a question directly. Super curious about Femi's question. Let me scroll up to see Femi's question. Cool. Oh, Femi, this is a very great question. Would you actually like to like unmute your mic and, you know, ask the question out loud so everyone else can get the context? Is Femi still on the call?
Yeah, hi, hello everyone.
Hi Femi, cool.
Yeah, okay, so my question is, have you ever worked with a non-technical CEO that is just focused on making your life miserable? Like you as a product manager working with teams, working with your engineers and your designers. The CEO right now, he doesn't understand a thing in tech, so he gets you to do the job. He doesn't want to give you the flexibility of doing the job. So he keeps imputing his comments and it doesn't make you understand. Do you understand? Do you get my question?
Yeah, definitely get a question. Anthony, do you want to take a crack at it? I could definitely also answer.
Sure. Yeah. So definitely I've worked with a startup CEO who doesn't have that tech background. Part of being a startup CEO is quickly build the company, right? And they may not have that the luxury of the tech experience. So my experience working with the CEO was trying to really understand what the problem or the issues are, first off with the dev team, and then try to translate the information in a way that the CEO would understand, right? So for example, you know, if if a particular feature, you know, will take a lot of effort due to XYZ technical constraints, then I could phrase it in a way that, you know, what we're working on is slightly more complex, and this is going to require a lot more effort from the dev team. And we don't want to release a half-baked feature for the end users, which will bite us, you know, later on.
Yeah.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Just to add to that, and I think Val had made an interesting point, which is it comes back to communication. One of the things I've done previously at a company is to communicate that what I did was, like, I wrote down all the features we would like to work on a whiteboard, and I wrote out a timeline. And, you know, I got the developers to draw a line where, you know, based off of the timeline, what is possible. And, like, it was written there plain and simple. And we all gathered around and made that presentation to the stakeholder. So it was absolutely clear that, hey, you know, this is everyone that's working on the feature. This is all the features that you want us to build in this timeline. This is what is possible. So there are different strategies that you can go about with it, but making it super clear that, hey, there's no way in hell this is going to happen, and letting them understand why, I think that would be super helpful, because then everyone can chime in and say, hey, I'm working on this, and the reason why it's going to take 2 weeks is because I have to do all of these things. So then it's like they don't have a choice, because ultimately, you know, that's, you're really giving them all you can do. But yeah, I know we are at time. I know we'd love to take more questions, but Felix, I wanted to pass it over to you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. It was great to talk about collaboration. So Felix, would you like to say any other things before we go? Definitely would like to also give the, you know, other panelists a chance to just say any last words.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, Ifemi. I really enjoyed this session. I want to say two things. The first one is, you know, turn on your cameras and put on the background, because we're going to take a selfie on this call. And so, you know, we're going to share that because today is May the 4th. And yeah, the other part is, of course, you know, thank you to all the speakers. I'm just really excited to be here, you know, listening. And the last question was, like, really funny, because, you know, just like as a founder with, like, you know, like, I would say, like, minimal technical expertise, because I used to be from an engineering school, that question, like, relates a lot, because, you know, even at ADPList, as you guys see, we move things really fast. But, you know, the thing is, of course, like, we sort of, like, move with the engineers, like, understanding the constraints and everything like that. So, you know, that was a very interesting question. And my tip one or two is to have that communication with the CEO, you know, talk to them and tell them about the constraints that you guys are facing. Sometimes he might think that, you know, it's not the truth, right? But you just have to communicate. Yeah. So I think that's just a great question. But yeah, thanks for me. I really enjoyed this session. I'm really looking forward to more with Co.Lab as well.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much. Yeah, communication is the key to collaboration. So just remember that if you ever get stuck. And thank you so much for all the panelists, Anthony, Malika, Mehek. You know, it was really fun chatting with you. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, let's take the picture now, Felix, whenever you're ready.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, I'm going to wait for a little bit more people to turn on their camera. Come on, guys, don't be shy. Yeah, turn on your camera, put on the background, you know. All right, I'm sending the photo again. All right, okay. I'm sure I don't have to turn on some music, you know, to get the mood going. But yeah, all right, let's, okay. Duel of the Fates. Someone asked me to play Duel of the Fates. Okay, I'm going to just play the normal one, all right? If I play Duel of the Fates, you know, people might think, like, that's a little bit too extreme. Oops. Okay. All right. I'm going to play that once we take the photo. Okay. I think we have enough people for the photo with the background. All right. Oh, Femi is turning on his camera or her camera. Okay. All right, let me just... All right, 3, 2, 1. All right, moving on to the second pitch. 3, 2, 1. And the last pitch, wow, I see some people putting that as their profile photo. Okay, 3, 2, 1. All right, awesome. Sufemi, back to you. You know, like, closing thoughts, anything before I start playing the outro music?
Yeah, well, thank you all so much for sticking around, and thank you all so much for your awesome questions. Really had fun chatting. Big fan of ADPList and their team. They move super fast. So shout out to the amazing work that you all do. If you're ever curious about Co.Lab and what we do and trying to get that real life experience collaborating with like product manager, product designers, you know, software developers, feel free to like check us out at joincolab.io. I know someone put it into the chat, so I'll just put it in again. We have cohorts monthly now. So if you're ever interested in getting that real life experience, feel free to just like join in, apply, and you get to like work and ship real products. So you can see some of the amazing products that some people have built on the website. And then you also get to see, we have a current cohort going on, and we have like so many amazing ideas that are already brewing, and we can't wait to see what they all come up with. So feel free to check us out. Hit me up anytime if you'd like to connect with me. Happy to chat about, you know, collaboration anytime. So thank you so much for having us, ADPList. Looking forward to more on this. And it seems like there's like a trend on Agile, so we might be able to do a talk on Agile maybe in the future, because we do have a talk at Co.Lab happening on Agile next week. So we can take some, you know, tenets from there and share it with the rest of the ADPList community.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, thank you all so much. Speakers and hosts, please stay back. And the rest of you, thank you all so much.
Bye, everyone.